As we begin, as we gather in, I want to read a little bit from Psalm 8. Psalm 8 is a psalm that reminds us of the greatness of God and that he is the all-powerful creator. O Lord, our Lord, your majestic name fills the earth. Your glory is higher than the heavens. When I look at the night sky and see the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars you set in place, you give them, that's people, charge of everything you made, putting all things under their authority. The flocks, the herds, the wild animals, the birds in the sky, the fish in the sea, and everything that swims the ocean currents. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name. We're going to sing together. First song reminds us that God is our creator God. We're going to stand together. If there's boys and girls near you, keep an eye on them. Some of them may know some of the actions, or if you do, join in with us as well. You put the stars in outer space, you pop the freckles on my face, and all the fish that swim and all the birds that fly were made from your incredible imagination. Let's stand as we sing.
The stars in outer space, you pop the freckles on my face, and all the fish that swim and all the birds that fly were made from your incredible imagination. Creator God, we sing into the Creator God of all the world. Creator God, we celebrate you. Stripes on every leaf, and all the grass that grows and all the leaves that fall are part of your amazing plans for this creation. Creator God, we're singing to the Creator God of all the world. Creator God, we celebrate you. We celebrate you. The sun, you place the heart in everyone, and all the music played and all the dancing done reminds us that we're made to be created by God. Creator God, we sing into the Creator God of all the world. Creator God, we celebrate you. Singing to the Creator God of all the world. Creator God, we celebrate you. Creator God, we sing to the Creator God of all the world. Creator God, we celebrate you. We celebrate you. We celebrate you. We celebrate you.
Good morning. We welcome everyone to our service today. We welcome any visitors who are worshiping with us. We gather together to worship God and to focus upon him. The psalmist says, ascribe to the Lord. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due to his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. Let all creation rejoice before the Lord, for he comes. He comes to judge the earth. Let's unite together in prayer. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we come today to worship and praise you. We praise you for your grace and for your goodness to us. We think of all that you have done for us in Christ. There is so much encouragement, peace, and hope as we think about him. We thank you, O God, that we know peace for now and forever in Christ, because you made peace through the finished work of Jesus. We thank you that we have continual access into your holy and joyful presence. We're no longer weighed down with guilt because we are standing in your grace. We no longer fear the future and things we cannot control. We rejoice with hope because we know one day your glory will cover this earth and you'll finish making us like Jesus. We pray that you will continue to pour out your love upon us so that there'd be less and less room for shame and foolishness, anger and anxiety, pride, and a whole lot of other things that contradict the gospel. We are yours by grace, and you are ours by grace. Help us, O God, in that confidence to come before you, to worship and to adore your name. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's do that as we stand together.
Lord our God, how majestic is your name. The earth is filled with your glory. Oh Lord our God, you are robed in majesty. You set your glory above the and splendor. Oh Lord our God, the skies are ringing with your praise. To those on earth shall come to worship. We will magnify, we will magnify the Lord enthroned in Zion.
These words. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light.
Mm-hmm. I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I have able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. Darkest nights, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. You have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath
Now the boys and girls may leave for children's church. Just want to draw your attention to a few announcements. We continue to meet each Sunday morning in the Burnie Room at 10 o'clock for a time of prayer, and I would encourage you to come and to share with us at 10 o'clock each Sunday morning. The Presbytery of North Belfast evening, joint evening services continue this evening. The service will this week will be in White Abbey congregation at 6:30. Should anyone be aware of any property emergencies during the summer period, would they please contact Mervyn Whittle? Reuben is due to return from holiday this week. He will conduct the service next Sunday, which will be the last Sunday service in the church building before we move to the McKinley Hall. And as from today, this will be the last day in which the service will be live streamed until we return to the church at the beginning of September. This is to facilitate the move to the the McKinley Hall. There will be a meeting of the Congregational Committee in the Burnie Room immediately after this service, and members of Kirk's session are asked please to attend the committee meeting. Members of the congregation will be sorry to learn of the death of Jeannie McBride, which occurred on Monday past. Her funeral service took place in the Old Presbyterian Church in Temple Patrick on Friday. We offer our sympathy and our prayerful support to her sons, David and Jeffrey, and the whole family circle at this sad time. So we're going to worship God as we bring to him our offerings, and then after the offerings, Jim Little will lead us in prayer.
We're going to sing together as we take up our offerings a song called These Are the Days of Elijah. It's a little bit of an unusual song, but in essence, it's a song of hope for the church. And in the world, in times of trial, God is not stepping back from the world, but he's calling us in the same way that he called Elijah and Moses and Ezekiel and David to make a stand for him, to offer right praises to him, and to declare that God is totally in control. And the chorus is the ultimate declaration of hope, that is Christ's return. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. Lift your voice in the year of Jubilee, for out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Let's stand together as we sing.
Days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword, still we are the voice in the desert, crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. Lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, out of Zion's hill salvation comes. These are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest, the fields are as white in the world, and we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. Lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, out in Zion's hill salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. Lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, out of Zion till salvation comes.
Let us all pray. Our Heavenly Father, we bow before your throne of grace this morning, And we do so in the precious name of our Lord and risen Saviour, Jesus Christ. And Lord, we pray by your grace that you will enable us to draw close to you and draw strength from the life of our Lord. We share this wonderful day together with believers from every corner around the world. So our prayers this day and praise that they may be worthy of you. And Lord, we give you humble thanks for the blessings that you shower on each one of us every day of our lives. And we thank you, Lord, for our families that are precious to us. We thank you, Lord, for our friends. And we thank you too, Lord, for the freedom to gather here this morning to worship you, the King of Kings. And Lord, we just remember our church family, and we thank you that you give answers to our prayers. Lord, many weeks go by and we pray for our friends and our families. And yes, Lord, there are many in our congregation who are recovering from serious illnesses, some from operations. And our prayer is that your great love and your mercy would surround them and give them the recovery that they so desire. Yet for those in our fellowship, Lord, who are in hospital even at this moment, that your healing hand would be upon each one of them. And in your love and mercy, Lord, that you would guide the consultants, the doctors, the nurses, as they continue to work in the healing process. And for those who are receiving treatment, Lord, I pray indeed for your blessing. Lord, that you'd meet each one of them at their point of need. Yes, Lord, there are so many in our church family today who are struggling with the demands of life, the cost of living, to pay for the ever-increasing bills and to put food on the table. Yes, Lord, we are a city and a country in crisis, and we would just pray this morning for the government at Westminster, for our local politicians, Lord, that you give them wisdom in their decision-making as they represent your people. And by your grace, help would be provided for those who are in need. And this morning, Heavenly Father, as we pray for the work of the street pastors connected with your church, in their work and witness, Lord, in our community, Lord, we pray that you would keep them safe, each one. And Lord, as they visit with the local towns and in Belfast, among the divided community, Heavenly Father, that you would keep them safe and as they continue to witness for you. And this morning, Lord, I particularly remember the ministers of our church, for Reuben and for George at this time. And Lord, as they continue to preach your word in this place, that you, Lord, would bless this work and bless this little congregation in the work of your kingdom in Glengormley. That souls would be saved, Lord, that your kingdom would grow, and may your Holy Spirit work in this place, Lord, to revive your people. We would remember to our friend Alison Orr, as she continues in her work and witness of the Japanese community. And remember to the Japanese Christian Fellowship as they will meet in Dublin. We do pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would be present in all that they do, and that your name would be raised high and glorified. Remember too Bethan, the youth worker and youth leader within our congregation, Lord, and for all those in our fellowship who take time to spend with our children. We pray indeed, Lord, as they witness to the saving grace of our Saviour, Lord, that these children would be blessed. Lord, they're precious wee souls, and we covet them for your kingdom. And Lord, this morning, as we remember the situation that goes on in our world, Heavenly Father, for the awful violence that continues to surround the Ukrainian people, for their struggle continues day after day, Lord, there have been bombings, there's devastation, and that continues every day at a pace. The persecution by Mr. Putin and his army has caused so much suffering, so much death, and it has brought starvation and homelessness and poverty. Lord, sometimes we forget about this and hardly remember them, Lord, when they're not in the news. But Lord, we ask indeed that you would be close by to this nation and bless them. So I would humbly pray, Lord, that you would bless not only this people, but bless those who would endeavor to bring peace. Remembering to the awful situation that there is in Gaza, locked in war, millions suffering, and there seems to be absolutely no end to this awful conflict. And Lord, with the world in such turmoil, I would earnestly pray, Lord, that priests would come. Lord, that you and you alone would intervene. All around the world, Lord, Christians are being persecuted. They're being murdered simply because of their faith. In North Korea, Nigeria, in India, in Afghanistan, in Pakistan. And these are just but a few of the places where persecution is rife. So, Lord, we're trusting in you and your unfailing love to deliver your people and to bring comfort and hope to each one. Yes, Lord, we're clinging to your promise that you would never leave or forget your people. And Lord, we just remember those of our fellowship who are grieving at this time for the loss of a loved one. And particularly the McBride family, Lord, in their recent loss during the past week. Lord, that they would know your comfort and your peace. May your Holy Spirit be close by to each one of them and give them the comfort that they so need. And Lord, as we continue this morning in our praise, in the reading of your word and the preaching of your truth, may your Holy Spirit be amongst us, that we would know your blessing today. And I do pray, Lord, that the words of our mouths and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. Amen.
Our thanks to Jim. We continue our studies in the book of Malachi. We're going to look today at Malachi chapter 3, verses 13 to 18. And then we will look at chapter 4, three Sundays from now. So we're looking today at Malachi chapter 3, and we're reading from verse 13 through to verse 18. Let us attend together to the word of God. You have said harsh things against me, says the Lord. Yet you ask, what have we said against you? You have said it is futile to serve God. What did we gain by carrying out his requirements and going about like mourners before the Lord Almighty? But now we call the arrogant blessed. Certainly evildoers prosper, and even those who challenge God escape. Then those who feared the Lord talked with each other, and the Lord listened and heard. A scroll of remembrance was written in his presence concerning those who feared the Lord and honored his name. They will be mine, says the Lord Almighty, in the day when I make up my treasured possession. I will spare them, just as in compassion a man spares his son who serves him. And you will again see the distinction between the righteous and the wicked, between those who serve God and those who do not. Amen, and God bless to our hearts and to our minds the reading of his own word. I remember when I was at college many years ago, of course, we had a teacher who was an eminent scholar in Old Testament. He was a very godly man. And when you asked him a question, there was always a period of silence. The question might have been something profound, or it might have been just about a Hebrew word. It didn't matter. There was always a period of silence. Sometimes we in our hurry thought he hadn't heard the question properly. But he never answered a question, no matter how trivial the question was. He never answered a question without thinking through what he was going to say. He was obeying the biblical injunction to guard your tongue. A lesson we all need to learn. The words we say can affect other people, our families, our friends, our neighbors, even ourselves. The words we speak can create an atmosphere in which we live. Our words, on the one hand, can create a world of encouragement and relaxation and support. On the other hand, our words can create an atmosphere of tension and despair and division. Which is true of your life? In the section of Malachi we come to today, the prophet was dealing with the subject of things people say. Malachi used a technique he had used before. He makes a positive charge against his hearers. Then he gave the kind of response he expected from them. This was usually a question which pretended they did not know what he was talking about. They pretended to be innocent. But the very question reflected their spiritual deadness and their spiritual arrogance. Then Malachi came in again in a more detailed way and nailed down their problem. He wanted the people to grasp the fact that they could use their tongues for evil or for good. And of course, so can we. So in verses 13 and 15, he talks about harsh talk. You have said harsh things against me, says the Lord. Yet you ask, what have we said against you? You have said it is futile to serve the Lord. Here are harsh, hard words spoken against God. Sometimes the dealings of God with human beings are difficult to understand. At such times, some Christians will quote you Paul's words, all things work together for good, in a shallow and almost a heartless way, which has very little feeling for those who are experiencing trouble. People who have served God faithfully and lovingly are not exempt from calamities. At such times of crisis, God expects us to be honest with him and to come and pour out our agonies before him, to pour out our disappointments humbly to him. Not to do so is to be less than real before God. We are brought low and we stand sometimes speechless before the mystery of God's purposes. But in faith, we reserve judgment on what God has allowed to happen. Only to know the end from the beginning. He is God, and we are human beings. However, in Malachi's time, there were people who, under the pretense of being honest, were taking it on themselves to jump to conclusions about God and his ways. They felt themselves to be truly godly. How dare God allow trouble to enter their lives? Their immediate response to the first hint of trouble was, it is futile to serve the Lord. What did we gain from carrying out his requirements? Their talk said that God did not keep his promises. Their talk slandered God's name. They said that God was unjust. What did we gain by going about like mourners before the Lord Almighty? There are some things that are inappropriate at a funeral. At a funeral, mourners, by and large, are careful to be on their best behavior. But these people were saying that they saw no point in being careful about serving God. Their talk was faithless. It is talk which arrogantly pointed the finger at God by the very people who accused others of being arrogant, verse 15. It is self-righteous talk by people who saw others as evildoers. It was talk which discouraged others from serving God. It makes people who hear it feel that there's no point in serving God, that they might as well give up. It was very dangerous talk spiritually. But God had been listening to the unguarded conversations of these people. Here were people who, because of their spiritual half-heartedness, blamed God for their circumstances. Their speech indicated not only their disappointments with God, but their disillusionment with God. We must beware lest we fall into the same trap. When things do not work out as we hope or wish, and when circumstances begin to press in on us, leading our lives in a direction we have not desired or expected, it is all too easy to become bitter in our spirits. This is what had afflicted Israel and so constantly in the days of their wandering in the wilderness, when they murmured and complained consistently and blamed God and God's appointed leaders. And all those years ago in the desert under Moses, and now in Malachi is accusing them of the same issues. Now in Malachi's day, when the restoration of a glorious work, when the walls had been rebuilt and the temple had been rebuilt, the people felt sorry for themselves. They did not count it a privilege to suffer for God and his work. They did not rejoice in tribulation. They did not see that hardship which enabled their faith to be purified for their long-term good. And as a result, they did not reap the benefits of God's gracious discipline. They were sour and said, "What is the use of serving God and trying to be good?" They said it was the arrogant and not the meek who were blessed by God, that it was evildoers who prospered by their wickedness, and that God was indifferent. They had not taken time to think of the doctrine of God, who is good and means nothing but good for his people. Do we blame God? When things happen in your life that are hard to understand or hard to cope with, do you blame God? Do you mock God? When minds are confused, feeling hurt, and spirits bitter, there is only one thing to do: turn to God. Do we do that? Or do we feel that God has let us down? Do we blame God for the situation we find ourselves in? Blaming God is a very serious sin. God does not promise that if we follow him, life will be easy. God does not promise that if we follow him, there will be no hardships or difficulties. Nowhere does God promise material prosperity or good health or ease. Christianity brought trouble and persecution and hardship to the people of the Bible, along with the joy of knowing Jesus. Paul, writing to the Romans, said, "I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed to us." We must not blame God. We must not shake our fist at God when the going gets tough. But remember that God can use the problems and difficulties of life to shape us for his glory and to prepare us for heaven. One of the biggest problems facing Malachi as he tried to bring these people back to God was the fact that they thought they had been giving themselves to God. They were saying to Malachi, "Look, we have served God and he has given us no blessing." They felt it was a waste of time to serve him. But the fact was that their service for God had only been half-hearted. Yes, they brought sacrifices to the temple, but any old animal would do. Instead of bringing a spotless lamb as God had instructed, they brought the weak, they brought the lame animals, which they would have had to slaughter anyway. They brought some offerings to the temple, but they didn't bring the tithe that God had instructed. Malachi's whole problem was their half-heartedness. They thought they were serving God and deserved his blessing, but they were not fully committed to him. It was their half-heartedness that was the reason God did not bless them. They nodded in God's direction, but that was all. They touched their cap to the Almighty, but they went on their own way. They never put God first. They wanted to serve God and self. Instead of blaming God, we should be examining our own lives. Where are we with God? What is God trying to teach us through the circumstances of life? But not all of Israel was speaking harsh words. There were also those who were speaking honorable words in verses 16 to 18. Some of the people realized that if they went on much longer in this climate of conversation, where all they heard poured out scorn to God, then very soon they too would end up bitter and faithless. And their response was to seek God and to enjoy fellowship with one another. Then those who feared the Lord talked with each other, and the Lord listened and heard. If we are wholeheartedly committed to God, then God and his ways should be part and parcel of our everyday conversation. This is what God had impressed upon the Jewish people from the beginning. These commandments, he said in Deuteronomy, these commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. The godly minority of Malachi's day were seeking to take that instruction seriously. Those who feared the Lord wanted him in all aspects of their lives. So they engaged together in conversation which honored his name, verse 16. These people were described as those who feared the Lord. To fear the Lord does not mean that we're afraid of God. It means to be in awe of God. It means to give God his proper place and his proper honor. Such awe delivers us from the fear of other people. And it brings depth and reverence and stability and peace of mind and heart, no matter what our circumstances. This godly fear is linked in our passage with two things. First of all, these people thought of God's name and pondered God's character. Increasingly, they were learning what God is like and being made to think of his sure promises. And we need to do the same. We need to think about God, to get to know him better in Jesus. Our God never changes. Our God does not lie. He is faithful and his mercies are new every morning. He has loved us with an everlasting love, and he refuses to give us up. They were preoccupied with the name and with the nature of God. And secondly, they had fellowship with one another. They spoke together about God. And this was something that many Christians never seem to get round to doing. It's so easy to speak about ourselves, about our problems, about other people's faults and failings. And in consequence, God is forgotten. Fellowship diminishes and our souls grow dry. Malachi goes on to tell us the Lord's reaction as he heard this honorable and encouraging conversation. God had pleasure in these people, and the Lord listened and heard. A scroll of remembrance was written in his presence concerning those who feared the Lord and honored his name. They will be mine, says the Lord God Almighty, in that day when I make up my treasured possession. I will spare them, just as in compassion a man spares his son who serves him. And you will again see the distinction between the righteous and the wicked, between those who serve God and those who do not. God recognizes and God delights in the conversation of those who fear him. Those people were taking practical steps to honor God and to strengthen their faith. They were seeking to help one another renew their faith, to renew their love for God. It was these conversations to which the Lord listened and heard. The scroll of remembrance was not a list of good deeds. It was a book of the name of those who feared the Lord and honored God. Their practical seeking to honor God, to encourage each other, trusting in the Lord, showed that they had true faith. And so their names were written in the Lamb's Book of Life. What an encouragement Malachi brought to this small remnant of faithful people. They were God's crown jewels, the pride of the Lord's treasury. They will be mine in the day when I make up my treasured possession. We see here an expression of determination in the Lord's love for his people. This is a God who's not just a mighty king, but a loving father. God is the father who takes delight in his children. His love is shown in his promise to spare his people. The scriptures tell us that God said, I will spare them as a man spares his own son who serves him. This is a God who is merciful. This is the God who is compassionate. This is the God who promises to spare his people, the God who promises to protect his people, the God who promises to preserve his people. This is a God who is not just a righteous judge, but a loving father who cares deeply for his children. That determination was such that Jesus went all the way to the cross for God's people. His love was such that no price was too high for him to pay. That's love. That's God's love. Have you responded to that love? Is your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life? Do you fear and honor the Lord? These verses from Malachi leave us with a challenge. God hears our every conversation. God listens to everything that we say. He misses nothing. He knows the bitter words that we speak. He knows the words of those who truly fear him. He knows every word we speak. That is why gossip and backstabbing and bitter words are ultimately pointless and fearfully sinful. It's told that the great Saint Augustine had a notice written up on his dining room wall, and it said this: he is unwelcome at this table who speaks an unkind word against an absent friend. Jesus said, but I tell you that when men will have to give an account on the day of judgment for every careless word they have spoken, for by your words you will be acquitted, and by your words you will be condemned. Our words, our conversation, are an insight into the state of our hearts. God challenges us to examine ourselves honestly before him today. What do our words tell us about the state of our lives spiritually? Here's a little thought as we finish. Before you speak, think. Is it true? Is it helpful? Is it inspiring? Is it necessary? Is it kind? Let's pray. Father, we come to you today thanking you for the challenge of your word, asking you will help us to examine our hearts and our minds before you honestly, and help us to consider the words that we speak. In Jesus' name, amen.
the Lord is King, your Lord and King adore. Mortals, give thanks and sing and triumph evermore. Lift up your hearts, lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say. Truth and love, when he had purged our state, he took his seat above. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say, hand till all his foes submit and bow to his command and fall beneath his feet. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say, rejoice. Rejoicing, glorious hope, Jesus the Judge shall come and take his servants up to their eternal home. We soon shall hear the archangel's voice, the trump of God shall sound, rejoice.
Bless our thanks to the band, to Jim for leading us in prayer, to those who've been on technology today, and for Addie and Amanda who've been looking after the children. Tea and coffee will be served in the mosaic immediately after the service. You're welcome to stay. I do remind the members of session and committee that they're meeting in the Burnie Room. Let's say the grace to one another. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.